Constitutional Conversations is a series of discussions by America's leading scholars about the principles, framing, ratification, and implementation of constitutional government in the United States. This series is hosted by the James Madison Memorial Fellowship Foundation of Alexandria, Virginia.
When you talk about an event like the American Revolution, it's easy to imagine, in a sense, as one damn grievance after another. One episode followed by another episode, followed by a third episode, until finally you reach a breaking point. And in many ways, I think that's a fairly conventional view of how the revolution happened. You start with a set of controversies in the mid-1760s over the Stamp Act. You, 2 years later, you have the debate over the Townshend duties, which ends in 1770. You have some other lesser disputes, you know, one involving Rhode Island, others involving New York, that go on during this period. So it's easy to say that there's, you know, you have this issue and that issue, and if you were to try to graph this whole thing, to say you have some kind of graph of resistance, you'd have like a 45-degree slope moving progressively upward until you reach 1.0, which would be independence. I have a very different view of the revolution. In my view, I think there were a pair of crises in the 1760s, you know, over the Stamp Act and over the Townshend duties, which in fact demonstrated potentially how deep a divide there was between the British position and the American position. Advanced arguments were made. You can see how the political elites in both countries were moving to adopt essentially irreconcilable positions on the nature of political authority within the empire. But after the Townshend duties were repealed in the spring of 1770, there follows a period of about three and a half years, which are actually quite fairly quiet. There are one or two disputes here and there, but nothing that really was atypical of what colonial politics had been like. The men we identify as the great early leaders of the revolution in the early 1770s, they're not sitting around all the time thinking about what should we do next to prevent the British from imposing tyranny on us or imposing arbitrary government on us. Many of them go back to their private affairs. They're perfectly happy to do so. I think many of them thought that the British government would have learned the lessons of the previous episodes. They would have realized from the Stamp Act and the Townshend duties controversies that the costs of imposing imperial policy on the Americans were just too high. The risks weren't worth taking. And the costs, you know, weren't worth paying. So I think what happened then, though, is that for, in a sense, almost an independent set of reasons, the crisis that began with the Tea Act in 1773, and that really comes in many ways out of the distinctive character of politics in Massachusetts, that became the wild card. That became the basis for a kind of scenario that I think only a few people had anticipated. Massachusetts, in some ways, you know, then as now, had a very distinctive, very kind of special political culture. It was the one province where you really did have a group of kind of hardcore radical leaders centering on Samuel Adams, first and foremost, who really were militants in opposition to the British government. And you also had a commanding figure in the person of Thomas Hutchinson, of American birth. In fact, you know, a member of a distinguished American family, going back to the famous Anne Hutchinson. In the 17th century. Hutchinson was an extraordinarily able and scrupulous servant of the British Empire. He had a long career holding different offices under the patronage of London. And he was deeply committed in his own way to preserving empire, so much so that he felt Americans had to accept some reduction in their abstract liberties because the benefits of empire were so obvious and so, you know, to him so manifest, and he felt his fellow colonists should think about it the same way. So what happens is you have a set of crises in Massachusetts. It begins when Hutchinson makes a very provocative speech to the Massachusetts General Court, the legislature, in early January 1773, basically saying all the positions they've been adopting in behalf of American rights, those positions are fundamentally flawed. Then there's a crisis that brews over the exposure of a set of private letters that Hutchinson had sent to correspondents in London. Franklin gets hold of these letters, sends them back to his friends in Massachusetts with the advice that they should be shown and not published, but soon everybody's heard about them, and eventually they were published, and they proved terribly embarrassing to Hutchinson. And then that's followed by the crisis over the Tea Act. So the Tea Act was a sequel to the Townshend duties of 1770. It lowered the duty on tea in the hope that if you lowered the duty, Americans might actually pay it. It was designed to relieve the difficulties of the East India Company, which was an enormously powerful and wealthy interest back in London, which was essentially on the verge of bankruptcy and wanted to have a monopolistic market over the sale of tea in America. When the Tea Act was being passed, no one's thinking very seriously about what consequences it might have had in the colonies. But once it's passed and the Americans start focusing on it, it became a fresh basis for resistance. It's out of this situation that you get the Boston Tea Party, which is, you know, Hutchinson, who's the governor, and whose sons were going to be the agents for the sale of East India Company tea. Hutchinson insists that the tea has to be landed and the duties on it paid. The Massachusetts radicals, led by Samuel Adams and John Hancock, say, no, that's not going to happen. The Boston Tea Party was the result of that. And out of the Tea Party comes the measures we call the Coercive Acts or the Intolerable Acts, where Parliament asserts its full jurisdiction and tries to punish Massachusetts in the hope of teaching all the other colonies these are the real cause of resistance. And instead, what happens out of that situation is the colonies unite in the Continental Congress and they put together a much more effective and much more cohesive form of resistance. But I think a lot really pivots on what Hutchinson did. When I try to explain this to my students at Stanford, you know, the point I try to make is this is one of those remarkable examples where you can really ask, what is the role of individual agency, of individual behavior in enforcing politics? When the tea ships went to other colonies, royal officials and their colonial opponents found ways to kind of work out the difficulty. Essentially, the tea is sent back to England unloaded. Hutchinson forced a crisis to take place in Boston. He had the same range of options, but he insisted, you know, perhaps out of his own personal frustration, that the letter of the law or his reading of imperial regulations, that had to be followed. And then you get this full-blown crisis. The British, of course, being British, were really outraged over the destruction of about 10,000 sterling pounds worth of property. And so they react in sharp opposition. Yeah, I think the Boston Tea Party, the circumstances that led to it and the reaction to it, I think these are kind of what historians call great contingencies. It could have happened a completely different way. If you can get past the tea crisis, I didn't think there was any real logic driving either the Americans towards resistance or the British towards further repression.
Constitutional Conversations is made possible by a generous grant from the Fairleigh S. Dickinson Jr. Foundation. Constitutional Conversations is made possible by the James Madison Education Fund.